मॉर्निंग क्लास, इन यस्टरडेज लेक्चर वी हैव अंडरस्टूड हाउ टू रीड द बाइनरी आइसोमॉर्फस फेस डायग्राम एंड फ्रॉम इट हाउ यू कैन प्रिडिक्ट द डिफरेंट फेजेस विच आर प्रेजेंट अंडर डिफरेंट टेम्परेचर एंड कॉन्सेंट्रेशन रीजियन, हाउ टू कंप्यूट द कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ वेरियस फेजेस एंड from using the concentration values how one can compute percentage of phases which are present at given point of interest on a particular phase diagram. In today's class we will going to understand how the solid is being formed in an isomorphous system. The process we will understood in two different conditions. First condition is during the equilibrium cooling. Equilibrium cooling is basically the slow cooling where your cooling rate is so slow that your phase which is evolving is always in equilibrium condition. So once we will treat the slow cooling rate and then we understand how the solid forms from the liquid phase. And in the second case, we will treat the non-equilibrium cooling case where your cooling will be rapid and the evolving solid will not be in the homogeneous phase. So under both the circumstances, how the developed solid will differ from each other, that we will try to understand. The process that we are trying to learn under equilibrium or non-equilibrium cooling is referred as development of microstructure. So what we are doing is we are trying to understand how the internal microstructure of the solid forms in an isomorphous system. So to understand that, let us look at this particular phase diagram, the portion of which only we are looking at because that is the point of our interest. You can see there is a black dotted line. The black dotted line is the concentration that we have in our system. So let us assume our initial system is the one which contains 35.8% of nickel and rest is copper. Remember, yesterday we were referring the isomorphous phase of copper and nickel. So we are taking the same example and our concentration is 35.8% of nickel. Let's assume that we have heat up this nickel-copper mixture to 1300 degree centigrade. So we have heated up to this particular temperature. So on the phase diagram, you will begin your journey at this particular point, or rather, let me mark it by a circle. We start with this particular point. Let's call this particular point as point A. So from 1300 degree centigrade, we are starting the cooling process. So now we will going to cool our sample from 1300 degree centigrade till 1100 degree centigrade. You can go below this as well, but whatever changes which the material is expecting to undergo will happen within 1100 degree centigrade. So even if you go up to room temperature, nothing more will happen. So what happens at 1300 degree centigrade? You can clearly see your first point, which is point A, is above the liquidus line. So what we expect is a single homogeneous phase of liquid, nothing else at 1300 degree centigrade. And what will be the composition of the liquid present at that particular point? So to find out the composition, you have to draw the tie line, which is nothing but the dotted black line. It hits the x-axis at 35.8%. So you can say the liquid, which is present at 1300 degree centigrade, contains only one phase, which is the homogeneous liquid phase with a 35 weight percent nickel in it. Now remember, when I write only 35% nickel, that doesn't mean the liquid contains only liquid. Remaining is copper. Copper is being kept as hidden term here. If you want to write, you can write both 35 weight percent nickel, 100 minus 35, which is 65% copper is present here. Now, if I start cooling this liquid, homogeneous liquid, which contains 35% nickel, it remains in the liquid state till I reach the liquidus line. Liquidus line, that is where our second point of interest is there. We have marked this particular point as point B. You can see I have marked point B. Now, this is the point where we expect the first solidification to occur, because the moment you touch the liquidus line, part of the liquid start getting converted to solid through the process of crystallization. That means part of the liquid will evolve as a tiny crystallites. Very small size crystals will be formed at this particular point, which you can see in the microstructure here. You can see there is light yellow color background. That light yellow color background represents the liquid, while certain dark brown color dots are being presented. Those dark brown color dots represents the tiny crystallites of the solid which is just formed. So now at point B, we have two phases. A primary phase is still the liquid phase, because most of it is still liquid, while the secondary phase is a solid phase. We used to call it alpha phase. So this is the point where your first alpha phase is formed. Now the question is, what is the concentration of liquid that we have? And what is the concentration of solid that we have? So if you remember, yesterday we did this exercise by drawing the tie line. So what we are doing is, we are drawing the tie line from point B. The tie line is the one which is the blue color line. So now if I take intercept from this blue color line, which is merging with the liquidus line at same point B, it will come out to be the same black dotted line, and hence the concentration will be 35 weight percent of nickel in the liquid phase. So as far as liquid phase is concerned, at this particular temperature, which is 1260 degree, your point B is 1260 degree. What is that temperature? This one. At this, your concentration of liquid is still same, 35 weight percent nickel, but the concentration of solid will be different. How do I know the concentration of the solid? For that, you have to find out the intercept of the tie line with the solidus line, which will be here, this point. And if I now take a vertical intercept from this point onto the x-axis, it will going to give me the concentration of the solid phase which is just evolved. You can see this number is 46 weight percent. It is mentioned both on the phase diagram as well as in this statement here. So at point B, you have two phases, namely liquid and solid. Your liquid has 35 weight percent nickel, rest is copper, while your solid, which is alpha solid, contains 46 weight percent nickel, while rest is copper. If I further cool the medium, means I am dropping the temperature from point B to point C. I am removing annotations so that you can clearly see now. So now we are at point C, and the corresponding temperature at this particular point is this one. Let us assume it is this one. Let us assume this particular temperature is 1250 degrees centigrade. Remember, you can precisely find out the temperature when your graph means when your phase diagram is on a graph sheet. So at this point, what happens? As you are going down, we know more and more liquid will turn to solid. That means your liquid phase shrink and your solid phase will continue to grow. Same thing you can see in the phase diagram which is shown here. You can see now you have fewer quantity of background yellow color present while your brown dots have grown in size. So if somebody asks what will be the concentration of liquid and what will be the concentration of solid, you have to again draw the tie line, which is the blue color line. Your concentration of the liquid will same because it will be slightly different because you have to now take the intercept on the liquidus line, which is at this particular point. So your concentration is slightly above 30%, which is more accurately mentioned here as 32%. So the concentration of liquid is 32% and concentration of the solid is somewhere here, which is mentioned as 43%. You can see that 43 number if I remove the annotations. Now you can read that 43%. You can see the values mentioned here. Now if I further move from point B to point D, you can see the point D is precisely at the solidus line. Now solidus line is the line which discriminates alpha plus L region with the alpha region. That means at this point, our most of the liquid will turn to an alpha solid while a very little amount of liquid is still left. You can say a negligible amount of liquid is left at this point. And if I ask you to find out the concentration of liquid and the solid, again, you will draw the tie line, which is the blue color line. The blue color line now intercept the liquidus line at this particular point. And if I take intercept on x-axis, it reads the concentration to be equal to 24% of nickel, rest is copper. And the concentration of the solid that I got is now same as the dotted line, which is 35% of nickel. So you can see the phase diagram, which is shown here at point D, contains 35% nickel in the alpha phase and 24% nickel in the liquid phase. Now, if I continue to cool it further from point D to point E, whatever is the leftover liquid will also turn to the solid alpha phase, whose concentration will be same as the dotted line, which is 35% of nickel. And what you get now is a single homogeneous alpha phase. Nothing else is present. This alpha phase contains 35% of nickel and remaining 100 minus 35, which is equal to 65% of copper. So this is the transformation that is happening in the sample when you are cooling it from 1300 degree centigrade to somewhere around 1100 degree centigrade, a pure homogeneous liquid will evolve into an alpha solid phase in a different manner. What you can see, an interesting region is the region between point B and point D, where both liquid and solid were present. An interesting thing is, as you move from point B to point D, that is when you are reducing your temperature, you have presence of both the solid as well as the liquid phases. If you talk about the concentration which you have, as your temperature drops down, the concentration of the solid which is formed also drops down, and the concentration of the liquid phase which is formed also drops down, keeping its mean value along the same line, which is your equilibrium concentration, 35%. So you can see your overall concentrations remains the same, but its distribution between the solid and liquid changes. Is it clear? Is there any doubt in the equilibrium cooling? Okay, this will happen when your cooling is slow. Now, let's talk about the second case where we will have a non-equilibrium cooling. Now, what is non-equilibrium cooling? Non-equilibrium cooling is the fast cooling. So now somebody can ask me, sir, how do I know whether my cooling rate is fast enough or it is slow enough? Which particular cooling rate we will refer as the fast cooling, and which particular cooling rate will be referred as the slow cooling? So there are no magic numbers that if your cooling rate is this much, it is fast. If your cooling rate is this much, it is slow. It varies from materials to materials. For example, you consider metals, then a cooling rate of couple of hundreds of degrees centigrade per minute is a slow cooling. And if you consider material like diamond, a cooling rate something like fraction of a degree centigrade per minute will be considered to be a fast cooling. So a small number could be fast and a very large number could be a slow, depending on nature of the material. Then how do I know for a given material which cooling rate is fast and which cooling rate is slow? So to identify this, you have to compare your cooling rate with another important physical quantity, which is called diffusion rate. So if your cooling rate is higher than the rate of diffusion, that means you are going fast. And if your cooling rate is lower than your rate of diffusion, that means you are going slow. So whenever you want to define whether you are under equilibrium cooling or under non-equilibrium cooling, you should compare your cooling rate with the rate of diffusion. If your cooling rate is higher than the rate of diffusion in the solid, your cooling is non-equilibrium cooling. And if your cooling rate is lower than the diffusion rate, then you are under an equilibrium cooling. So the previous case that we have discussed is the one where your cooling rate was slow, so that your rate of cooling is lower than your rate of diffusion. Now we are considering the faster case, that is under non-equilibrium cooling. Again, we start at 1300 degree centigrade. So at this particular temperature, when we start along point A prime, just to distinguish from the previous case, this time we mark it as A prime. So at this particular point, your temperature is around 1300 degree centigrade and your concentration is along this dotted line, which is 35.8% of nickel. So at this point, you still have one homogeneous liquid phase, which contains 35.8% of nickel, and it remains homogeneous liquid till you intersect the liquidus line. You can see your intersection point with the liquidus line is marked as B prime. So B prime is the point where first solidification will occur. If you read the corresponding temperature on the y-axis, your point B has temperature which is roughly 1260 degree centigrade. Remember, you can get the precise values on the graph paper. So for a time being, let's assume this temperature is 1260 degree centigrade. At this point, what we expect is most of this, the material is still in a homogeneous liquid phase, while a little solid will just crystallize, which you can see in the phase diagram that we have marked. So mostly we have a background liquid as yellow, and then you can see few brown color dots, a tiny dots, which represents the solid which is just formed. And you can also find out the concentrations of the solid and the liquid by drawing the tie line and then vertical intercepts on the x-axis. So I am mentioning this value. For alpha solid, this value is coming out to be 46 weight percent nickel, which is mentioned here on the phase diagram itself. And the liquid is same concentration as the dotted line, which is 35 weight percent. For clarity, I am removing the annotations. So you can see the phase which is formed at point B has two phases, namely the liquid with 35 weight percent nickel and an alpha solid with 46 weight percent nickel. Now, if I go from point B to point C or to point D, what happens? A newer and newer solid will form with lower and lower concentration of nickel in it. Why it is so? Because as you go down, you can see your concentration of the solid formed keep decreasing. So what happens in the evolved phase at point D, which is at the intersection of the solidus line, you can see you still left with certain amount of liquid in it, while most of the solid which is formed has different concentrations of nickel in it. Why it is so? It is because we are undergoing with a non-equilibrium cooling. So what happens is the first solid that was formed, which was containing 46 weight percent nickel, will be in the core region of the solid. Your innermost core has the highest concentration of nickel, while the next solid which forms will contain slightly lower amount of nickel into it. And as you cool it further down and down, you can see the evolving solid will contain lesser and lesser amount of nickel in it. That means the developed solid is the one which contains the highest concentration of copper at the center of the nucleation. And as you evolve the solid, that means more and more solid will grow, its concentration will keep decreasing. That means at the center, you have highest concentration of copper, and as you come out, the concentration decreases. This you can see in this particular phase diagram, which now I am marking. You can see here. Your alpha in the center has 46.8% nickel. Then the next layer has 40%, and then next layer has 35%. Which are these points? These points are the one which is point B prime, C prime, and D prime. If you continue to cool it further from D prime to E prime, what you can see is your entire liquid has now turned to a solid phase, where again your concentration will be highest at the center and it keeps decreasing below that particular point. So if I zoom up the solid form, it will look somewhat like this. The solid that is formed under non-equilibrium cooling will form its structure, which is somewhat like this, where your center has the highest concentration of the evolved solid. So this portion has the highest concentration, which is 46.8% of the nickel. And as you go away from the center, that is as you move out, you can see the contrast color keeps decreasing. This decrease in the contrast referred to decreasing concentration of nickel in it. So as you progress in the cooling, the evolved phase will contain different concentration of nickel, which will be lower as compared to the previous one. This kind of solid structure is referred as the cored structure. So whenever you cool the liquid at a faster rate, which is under, say, non-equilibrium cooling, you end up with a solid which is having the cored structure. Cored structure is the one where you have concentration gradient within the solid. Your concentration will be highest in the center of the solid, and as you move away from the center of the solid, your concentration keep decreasing. Remember, on the surface of the solid, which is the outermost layer, your concentration of the solid will be least. While in case of the equilibrium cooling, the previous case where you were going slow, your evolved solid will contain a homogeneous concentration. So everywhere, whether you are looking at the center of the solid or you are looking in the outer region of the solid, your concentration will always be the same. Why it is like this? It is because your rate of cooling is slow, that whatever is the concentration gradient which is there in the solid will get nullified by the diffusion of atom. So in reality, when the solid forms in the non-equilibrium cooling, in the equilibrium cooling as well, your center has higher concentration as compared to your outer region. So your first solid formed will have higher concentration as compared to the next one. But what happens, since you are going very slow, this higher concentration from the center will diffuse out into the other region, and the diffusion will continue till the homogeneous equilibrium is attained. So as the solid grows further more and more, the new evolving solid in this region has lower concentration, like say, has lower concentration, but the higher concentration from the central region will keep diffusing outward till everything is under a homogeneous face. So at every point in time, you can see your solid contains one homogeneous concentration across it. While in the non-equilibrium cooling, the distribution of concentration is different at different points within the solid. Is it clear? Is there any doubt? Okay, so this was all about the isomorphous system. Remember, isomorphous has only one solid phase, which was an alpha solid. Now we refer to the phase diagram of binary eutectic system. So as the name suggests, binary means you will still have your solid, which is made up of two components. So your constituents will be two different elements. And in eutectic solid, you will have two solids present simultaneously. So we will refer it to an alpha solid and a beta solid. One such eutectic phase diagram we have already studied in our laboratory classes, which was the phase diagram of lead and tin. So here we have the same phase diagram, and let us quickly take a look at what the phase diagram represents. So like any other phase diagram, this is a plot or say graph of temperature on the y-axis. So on the y-axis we have temperature, and on the x-axis we have composition of one of the element. So we are plotting on the x-axis as composition of weight percent of SN. You can also identically plot composition for weight percent of the PB. So what you can see on the phase diagram is couple of brown color, dark brown color lines. These lines represents the liquidus line, the solidus line, and the solvus lines. So the topmost line is the liquidus line. Whenever you are above this line, which particular line? The one which I am referring with the cursor now. This line is the liquidus line. So whenever you are above this, you will always be in one homogeneous phase, which is a homogeneous liquid phase. So irrespective of concentration, if you are above the liquidus line, you will always be in a liquid state. You can see your liquidus line is an inclined line. So your temperature up to which you get a liquidus phase will vary at different concentration and at different temperature. Then you can see this horizontal line. This horizontal line where my cursor is there at this point is the line which is referred as the solidus line. So below this, you end up with one particular phase, which is the solid phase. But this time, the solid has different chemical compositions and they primarily form two different solids with two different compositions. For the time being, let's call them alpha and beta. So alpha is one particular solid having one chemical composition, while beta is another solid with a different chemical composition. Then you can see two different solvus lines, and these two different solvus lines contains a region where only one phase is present, which is called alpha phase. And identical to that, you have on the opposite side where only one phase is present, which is the beta phase. So you have either a pure liquid phase or a pure alpha solid phase or a pure beta solid phase or a mixture of alpha plus beta face in different regions of the face diagram. Apart from these four regions, you have two other important regions. One of them is semi-solid phase, which is made up of alpha liquid, alpha and the liquid, while the other region is also a semi-solid phase, but this time your solid phase is the beta phase. So you can have either alpha plus L or the beta plus L. And last is you get one important common point on the phase diagram where immediately above that particular point you have your phase which is homogeneous liquid, and immediately below it your liquid is turning into the solid phase. So this particular composition is referred as the eutectic composition, where your entire liquid simultaneously turns into two different solids, namely alpha and beta. And the corresponding temperature is being referred as the eutectic temperature. So this is the eutectic temperature. This horizontal line, which is running parallel to the eutectic temperature, I mean this particular portion of the phase diagram, is also called the isotherm or eutectic isotherm. So from eutectic point, you find out the eutectic composition, which is the intersection on the x-axis. So this is your eutectic composition. If you take intercept on the y-axis, you find out the eutectic temperature, and the horizontal line representing the eutectic isotherm. If you remember, in the cooling cow experiment, for some time, we have no drop in the temperature. Your temperature was remained constant as a function of time, even though you were cooling it. Why that was happening? That was happening because you were at this isotherm. Whenever you are at the isotherm, your temperature becomes constant because it is in the equilibrium. Both your solid and liquid is in the equilibrium state. So at the isotherm line, your solid and liquid will always be in the thermodynamic equilibrium. So we have a couple of definitions here. Most of them I have covered. Eutectic point is the point where two liquidous lines meet. Which are those two liquidous lines? Let me show them. So you can see, you have one liquidous line here and another liquidous line here. So eutectic point is the point where two liquidous lines meet, or you can say this is the point where a homogeneous liquid upon cooling turn to two different solids, namely alpha and beta. So you can define a reaction that is called eutectic reaction. Eutectic reaction is the one where a homogeneous liquid with some concentration CE, why I am writing it E? E refers the eutectic. So it's a concentration at the eutectic point. So liquid with a eutectic composition CE upon cooling turns to two different solids, namely alpha and beta, where the concentration of the alpha is defined as C alpha E, that is concentration of alpha phase at eutectic point, and concentration of beta is being defined as C beta E, and again here E marks the eutectic point. The third definition, which I have already covered, is eutectic isotherm. This is basically the horizontal solidus line, which is passing from T equal to TE. So if I draw a horizontal line at T equal to TE, what I get is this line, which is nothing but your eutectic isothermal. Any doubt up to this point? Okay, we are running out of time. So we are closing our today's discussion. In tomorrow's class, we will discuss how the different phases evolve during the cooling. So the way we discuss evolution of the phases today, we will do the same discussion tomorrow for the eutectic system. So I am closing now.